Thanks very much. Great honour to be with you this morning. Many years ago, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones wrote a book called Preaching and Preachers. And he talked about the fact that, he talked about the fact that it was tradition to have 3 points when you preach. And some people became totally hidebound by this fact, and he gave one example of it. And he was, because he was saying that there's no real reason why you've got to have 3 points, but it's become a tradition. And he talked about one South Wales preacher who preached on the verse Balaam, the Old Testament verse, Balaam rose early and saddled his axe. That was his verse. Now his first point was early rising is a virtuous thing. Obviously, early to bed, early to rise makes Jack
healthy
and wise. Healthy and wise, that's right. So I can see the point of that. The second point was saddlery is an ancient art. I don't know what that's got to do with Christianity, but there we are. And then, of course, he was stuck for a third point. So he said, for my third point, I want to say a few words on the woman of Samaria. I remember reading that and laughing my socks off. But I must confess, I've only got 2 points this morning. The first point is that Jesus loves me. And the second point is that I can trust him. Now, they're far more profound than you might imagine, you know. I've got a coaster at home saying, Jesus loves you, but I'm his favourite. I believe that. I bought it deliberately. I am his favourite.
So am I, Paul.
Yeah, so are you. We are all Jesus' favourite. He loves us with a love beyond imagination. You know, the word compassion is rarely used in the New Testament, and it talks about Jesus looking at the people with compassion. And it's the Greek word for compassion is derived from the intestines, strangely enough. In other words, when he looked at the people, his gut was wrenched. His heart was burst. That's how he saw the people before him. And this morning when Jesus looks at you, he is full of compassion. He sees your struggles and your trials. He sees your heartaches, the problems you face, the times you mess up. We all mess up. He sees every one of those. He is moved with compassion. He delights in you. Now, there's a wonderful illustration of this in the Old Testament. Some of you have heard me say this, I'm sure, before. King Xerxes, the Median king, had a problem. He had a very beautiful wife called Vashti. That wasn't his problem. But it became his problem because he was holding a big feast and he wanted to show her off. So he sent his servants and commanded that she come. Now, the problem was that Vashti had embraced women's lip. And as a result, she refused to go. Why should I? You know, all he wants to do is show me off, but I'm not going. He was devastated. I mean, this was unthinkable, especially in those days. And his advisors were hopping mad. They said to him, we can't let her get away with this. If word of this gets round and people know that nothing is done about it, our wives will do the same. They'll become women servants. They'll not as they're told. They become disobedient wives. We've got to do something about it. So as a result, she was banished. And of course, that left him without a wife. The plan was to get a new wife. And he sent servants into every area, every county, every part of his empire to hunt for beautiful girls. And they brought these girls, the most beautiful they could find, they brought them back to the capital. Now, it didn't finish there. They had 12 months treatment. The first 6 months was massage, exfoliation, bathing. Wonderful. The second 6 months was aromatherapy, perfumes, serious pampering. And at the end of these 12 months, he had the unenviable task of picking the one who was going to be his wife. And can you imagine this? Now, amongst these girls, there was a Jewish girl who'd been captured when his armies had invaded Israel, and her name was Esther. Xerxes took one look at Esther, and he was smitten, and his heart melted with him, gave over. She was the one. He fell head over heels in love with Esther. And as a result, she became the queen. Well, there was a problem. His right-hand man was a man called Haman, and Haman was plotting genocide against the Jews. And Esther had an uncle called Mordecai, and Mordecai got wind of all this. And he got word to Esther about it, and she went to see him, and he talked to her, and he said, "Now you've got to do something about it. You've got to go and see the king. You've got to stop all this. Somehow or other, you've got to stop it." Now, this was a predicament for her. You see, she couldn't just go and see the king. She had to wait for the king to send for her. And she didn't know how long that was going to take. If she went in unannounced, and presented herself to the king, it meant the automatic death penalty. That was the rule, that was the law. Automatic death penalty. There was one exception. If the king held out his golden scepter, when the person entered his presence, they were reprieved. So she asked the people, the Jews, to fast and pray, which they did. And she put on her royal regalia, her robes. And with fear and trepidation, she entered the king's presence. Xerxes took one look at her, and he was smitten. His heart melted within. He held out the golden scepter. I want to tell you this morning that when God looks at you, he is smitten. And his heart melts within him. He loves you. If you don't believe me, read the book, The Song of Solomon. And read it in the NIV. Because it's got headings there. And you know who's actually talking. And it's got headings, for instance, lover, beloved, friends. So you know whether it's the lover speaking, or the beloved speaking, or the friends. And What's amazing about this, it's a likeness, it's an allegory, if you like, of Christ and his church, of Jesus and you. And we are the bride of Christ. That's what the scripture teaches, that the church is actually the bride of Jesus Christ. What's so amazing is not what she says about him. How handsome he is, how strong he is, how sturdy are his legs and all the rest of it. It's what he says about her. The tender adoration with which he describes every part of her body. How beautiful are you, my darling? Oh, how beautiful, your eyes are doves. Oh, how beautiful you are, my darling. There is no flaw in you. When Jesus looks at you, he sees no flaw. He only sees beauty. Why? Because he has clothed you with his righteousness. He has covered you with the goodness that he has. Every good deed that he performed when he walked on this planet Earth, every act of kindness, love, compassion, mercy, tenderness, everything that he did is credited to you and covers you. He has given you his righteousness. And when he looks at you this morning, he sees no flaw. And he loves you with a passion. He loves you with a passion. Because of that, I can trust him. I can trust him implicitly. Whatever happens in life, and sometimes things happen which we don't understand. And we can have loss, we can have pain, we have suffering sometimes. Things happen which we will never understand in this life. One day we will, when we see him. And Scripture says that we shall know as we are known. But sometimes things happen which are mysterious to us. But in everything, I can trust him. Over 20 years ago now, I developed a drink problem. And as a result of it, I subsequently was admitted to the Priory Rehab for 28 days. And whilst we were there, we did what they call the first four steps of the 12-step program of Alcoholics Anonymous. And we had to do them in group format, so there were about 12 to 16 in the group, depending on the part of the month and how many had come in and how many had left. And we did each of those. The first step is we admitted that we were powerless over alcohol and our lives had become unmanageable, which was obvious in my case. The second step is we came to believe in a power greater than ourselves who could restore us to sanity. So it introduced the concept of a higher power in our lives. Now that wasn't a problem to me because I believed in God. I'd always gone to church. I was Christian and the concept of a higher power was no problem to me. God was my higher power. And the third step was that we turned our lives and will over to God as we understood him. And I came, remember, very, very vividly, I did my third step, and I took this seriously at the time. And it wasn't so much my will as my life, which I could do nothing about. At that moment in time, the Halifax Building Society had fixed the date to take me to court to repossess my house. My finances were in such a mess. My wife at the time knew nothing about this. I didn't dare tell her because that would have meant more rows. And there were frequent rows. In fact, there were rows every single day. It was one of the reasons why I didn't think I could stop drinking. You know, I needed the vodka to quieten my fears. So if there's a round of vodka, ideal, you know, worked. Or it worked to a point. My two sons, I remember my eldest son standing in the doorway. They were grown up, they were still at home though. In fact, I got to the point where I never thought my eldest son was ever going to leave home. But he stood in, I remember him standing in the doorway, and I was a drunken swab in the chair. And he said, just to think, Dad, I used to really respect you. My youngest son had marks on his knuckles that I used to punch through the door in his distress, you know, he was so emotional. So life was, and my wife at the time, she sadly, unfortunately, she eventually died. And now married to the lovely Susan. But she was very angry. Incredibly angry. I could do nothing about any of all this. I remember handing it over to God and feeling an incredible sense of relief. The problems hadn't gone away, they were still there. But as far as I was concerned, they were my problems no more. They were God's problems. And I want to tell you this morning that whatever problems you're facing, they're not yours. They're God's. The next day, I got chatting to a solicitor who was a patient with himself in the rehab, and he was from Liverpool, and I chatted to him about the Halifax Building Society, hoping for some tips, you know, on how to avoid losing my house. And he said, which firm of solicitors are they using? So I told him, he said, well, we're just about going to take that firm over. He said, I'll see what I can do and get it put on hold. That was the following day. And he managed it. I don't know how he did it, but he did it. I never lost a house. I never lost my job. I retired at 65 as normal. I never lost my family. But what it did to me, it made me convinced that whatever happened in life, if I had lost everything, my job, my home, even my family, I would be okay. Amen. Because my life was in the hands of the Almighty. Yes. And life would go on, and I would be okay. And I want to tell you this morning that whatever happens in your life, whatever goes on, you are in the hands of the Almighty, who loves you so desperately that you can trust Him whatever happens. And I remember coming out of that place, and life was still very difficult. My wife was angry for years. My finances got better very quickly. My health, physical health, improved. My relationship with my sons got better quickly. My relationship with my wife took years, literally years. case of me going to Alcoholics Anonymous, and did her best to try and stop me, but I was determined I was going to go, so I kept going, because that was so important to me. But I remember coming out of there and thinking, whatever happens, I will never worry again. Nothing will ever fail me. No, of course, that's not true. That's what I thought at that time. I was so convinced that all I had to do was, if something happened, in, like I handed it over to God, He would take care of it. Because things, God has a habit sometimes of ratcheting up the arts, if you like, and making it a bit more. He knows my weakness. And things happen sometimes which give me fear. Things happen which my initial reaction is to duck and dive and wheel it, you know, to get out of it somehow, which is what I always was like inside. But if I work on handing it over to Him, it works. And I hand it over to Him and I say, whatever the outcome is, I don't dictate the outcome. Your will be done, like Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Yes. And He faced a trial far more serious and big than, infinitely big than, anything that we can face. If I can say to Him, your will be done, I hand it over to you. Trust you in this. Yeah. That's when I get peace. That's when I get serenity. You know, at the end of every Alcoholics Anonymous meeting, we join hands and we say the serenity prayer together. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change. The courage to change the things I can. The wisdom to know the difference. And it's that acceptance of the things I cannot change. If I can change it legitimately, legally, morally, if I can do that, then I am, it's incumbent upon me to do so. And I sometimes need courage to do that. If I can't change it, I have to trust Him. So my message to you this morning is two points. One is, God loves me. He loves you. You're His favorite this morning. I'm His favorite this morning. I can trust Him. And you can trust Him. Whatever is going on in your life at this moment in time, hand it to Him. If you can't change it, you can either worry about it or give it to Him. Let it become His problem. Yes. When I handed my life over to Him at that moment in the priory, I was so relieved. You know, the problems were still there, but they weren't mine. I'd given them to God. And He owned my life.